So the next question is about mentors, supporters, or followers. Now, who are the people who have supported your development as a leader, and how do they support you? Anyone? Someone else can start this time. Steve, do you want to?
Well, there's been really two huge influences in my consciousness about leadership and mentoring. First one is Dr. Stephen Covey. Mm-hmm. I mean, that one book when it came out, it's the first book in my life. I just opened it up and I couldn't not finish it, you know. It just spoke to me. Mm-hmm. There was something going on there. So the things I learned from Covey, that there's a gap between stimulus and response. And in that gap, we have a millisecond to choose. Do we do the right thing or do we do the wrong thing? So I think exercising integrity in the moment of choice for me is big. Doing the right thing based on your conscience and your voice. That's one thing I got from Covey. There's a lot of other stuff too, but that was the big one. There's another disciple of leadership, Robert Greenleaf, who developed servant-based leadership. I'm not sure if anyone's familiar with that. You know, for years and years and years, I was driving change, installing computers, pissing a lot of people off in organizations because yet again, here I am installing stuff and changing what was already working quite well for something that's problematic. And getting beaten up a lot. But in the course of time with the teams of people I was leading to achieve all of those complex things, I found I was caring a lot about them. I was caring a lot about my team, whereas other teams didn't seem to give a toss about everybody else. I just felt it was quite right to care about the people I was responsible for. It felt right. And I was actually looked down upon by quite a few other co-project people. And I was made to feel I was a bit weird. Well, I felt a bit weird until Robert Greenleaf's book darkened my doorstep, and I thought, hey, this is perfectly acceptable to help develop competency in other people. If you see a spark of innovation or creativity, develop it, get it out of them. They'll feel good for it, you feel better for it. So Greenleaf's servant-based leadership has taught me, be a servant first. Don't bang your chest as the big leader. Get in there and support your team. Create a safe, nurturing environment for them to fire. You do that and it's wonderful for everybody. So those are the two main influences in my leadership thinking, and they still are to this very, very day. Those of you who know quite a bit about them, that comes from a transformational leadership model perspective where you transform stuff that's in people into something that's better. Whereas my military background was very, transactional. You do this, then you do that, and then the other thing, which was okay in a military context when lives are on the line. That's me.
Thank you.
Can we?
Everything he says.
Have you read those books? That's too
flat.
Too much.
Yeah, don't let him go first again.
Sorry.
Time's up. I think for me, probably my biggest, my parents, they're my biggest supporters. I've got twin boys, they're 16, and through the years, I've had to I've got to go off, do this, do that, and what have you, and so they're like, go for it, you do whatever it takes, and so it's always good to have family backing you up, you know, in anything you do. As in books and stuff, like I read heaps of books. A lot of them are like self-help, how can I do better, and how can I be a better person, and what have you. There's a few books that stand out, but don't, you know, like it's in yourself. I believe everything is within yourself, and getting around people that are like-minded as you, and not to be around people that are going to just put you down for it, because it's that tall poppy syndrome in New Zealand, you know, people don't like people getting ahead. And so I've had to really fight against a lot of stuff, especially in my community. A lot of people are for it and a lot of people are against what's happening up there. And so I've just had to say, I'll stuff you all, and I'm doing it anyway, you know? Because at the end of the day, it's yourself you got to live with, you know, not what people say in your head. So, so the biggest have been my parents and really good friends, you know, just saying, you can do it, you can do it, you can do it. And my children, although they've not really wanted to do stuff that I wanted to do, they're still there going, you can do it, Mum. So, yeah, they're my biggest champions.
Thank you. Lisa?
Yeah, I think I'm very similar to you, rather than the more theoretical side of things. My family have been, my upbringing, being brought up to always be kind and put other people first, it was the number one thing. You never lie, you never not be kind, and I still can't lie to this day. They're blushing. Yeah, and also me and my family now who are supporting me with the time, obviously the commitments. I mean, the beach and boat, we live it. In the last 3 months before the event, it's 7 days, and people coming in home all the time, the phone ringing constantly, you know, and it's a huge intrusion on our family life. Massive intrusion. And the weekend of the event, well, I lose my voice. The children don't see me for 4 days, except for when they're running quickly. So, yeah, without that support, none of it would happen. But then also I'd like to probably have to say the community as well, because I have probably 150, 200 volunteers that help out during the weekend, and then there's a huge other number that help throughout the year with all the mail outs and all the other stuff that I do. And without them, I don't know what, it just wouldn't happen. And I actually feel incredibly humbled. There's nothing more humbling than having people wanting to help you for nothing in return other than they're going to have a good time. And what you said was very, very, very pertinent about being kind to people and putting them first and not beating your own chest. I never ever do that. They're my number one people and they always come first, and there's nothing I'd ask them to do that I don't do. I mean, the weekend of the event, I could be swanning around and in the sponsors bar drinking free drinks probably, but I don't. I'm in there mucking in, and because you've got to, it's your passion that drives them, and if you're not constantly feeding them your passion, they'll run out of steam. And I do things like I have crew parties, you know, my house gets taken over 3 times a year and I feed them up, drink them up, you know, make sure they're having a good time, and they get stuff from me, and that. So that side of it's all really critical, very critical.
Okay, thanks a lot.